Okay, I am honored to be here and present my paper. I talk about the transformation, the sustainability of East Asian development model, but this is Korean special, because this is Korean session, I would like to focus on Korea. I'll argue that there are four trends of institutional change in East Asian development model: marketization, privatization, liberalization, and flexibilization. This study aims to clarify how these institutional changes have transformed EADM in Japan, Korea, and China. I'll argue that EADM has transformed into a hybrid model in which the elements of the Anglo-American model was grabbed onto the EADM. It will be clarified that unsustainable growth regimes have emerged in the transformation process. Table 1 shows the prototype of East Asian development model. It is a kind of a stylized effect. Anyway, developmental states, authoritarianism and industrial policy in the state sector, and conglomerate dominance, Gate in Japan and Jabal in Korea and SOE in China, and inside the oriented governance and relation-based contracting rather than arm's length transaction. And in financial sector, bank-based system, financial reflection and the patient capital, and how about the labor system, long-term employment, lifetime employment, and the seniority wage systems, and enterprise unionism. In trade sector, strategic opening, export promotion, and capital control. Based on this capital control, the export-led growth regime was basically the East Asian specific growth regime. Development state, I think it is a little different from extractive state and neoliberal state and welfare state. The result of marketization and privatization was reduction in the size of market. The dramatic transformation was the privatization of SOEs in China. Economic freedom index in terms of government size has increased considerably in China and Korea. As you can see in table 2, the smaller government earns higher ratings. So now Korea has the smallest government in the world. I chose three countries, the United States, because this is representative country of Anglo-American model, and Germany is a representative country of Rhine model, and Sweden is a representative country of Nordic model. Anyway, Korea has the smallest government. How about liberalization of financial market? Among five sectors, financial sector is very important because financial liberalization initiated the transformation of East Asian development model. I saw the two indicators of financial liberalization. One is economic freedom index constructed by Gartner et al. And the other was is financial liberalization index from financial reform data set of IMF. You can see in table 4, trends of capital liberalization in Korea, China, and Japan. You can see here, Korea had liberalized capital from 1990s. And after crisis, it stopped the capital liberalization. But in 10 years, Korea liberalized capital market again, rapidly. Now the indicator of capital liberalization in Korea is very high, higher than even in United States, it is very interesting. Figure one shows the financial liberalism index. You can see here the trends of financial liberalization, Japan, Korea, China. Japan liberalized financial markets from 80s, around 80s, and Korea liberalized financial market around 1990s. Anyway, and China is liberalizing financial market steadily. In Japan, there was a transition to financial system from bank-based system to market-based system. After Japanese Big Bang in 1998, foreign investors entered into Japanese stock market. Korea liberalized financial market dramatically just before the 1997's financial crisis. You can see here the trend. Short-term external debt increased drastically before the crisis. It was one of the causes of the financial crisis in 1997. With the financial liberalization, transformed the corporate governance significantly. You can see in figure two, the ownership structure by type of shareholder in Japanese listed company. Professor Miyajima already showed this figure, but I will explain more about this. You can see here, city and regional banks, the proportion of city and regional banks decreased sharply in 2000s. As you might know, city and the regional bank is the main bank. The share of main bank in ownership decreased sharply. By contrast, the share of foreigners increased sharply, about 30%. Figure three shows the Korean case. You can see here the share of government and public companies. It decreased below 5%. By contrast, the share of foreigners increased rapidly. It amounts to 35% now. This change in corporate ownership has forced managers of the firms to adopt the principle of shareholder capitalism. The press to focus on shareholder value precipitated the shift of corporate governance from the relation-oriented, stakeholder-oriented model to the market-based, shareholder-oriented model. In Korean case, the element of shareholder capital introduced into existing Jevol system, so Korean capital, Korean corporate system transformed from Jevol system to the Jevol system plus shareholder capitalism with the premise of the former. This is important, with the premise of Jevol system. I'll argue that the transformation of corporate system in Japan, Korea, and China was introduction of a principle of shareholder capitalism and the element of shareholder capitalism merged into existing Geiryoju system in Japan, Jevol system in Korea, and even SOG system in China. This suggests that kind of a hybridization rather than a complete transition occurred in the corporate system. I'll talk about changes in labor market. According to the institutional complementarity hypothesis, these transformation in the public sector, corporate sector, and the financial sector should be followed by flexibilization of labor market. You can see in table six, the collapse of internal labor market. The share of hiring of newly graduated students decreased rapidly. By contrast, share of hiring of experienced workers increased rapidly. This shows the breakdown of internal labor market in major Korean companies. And this resulted in decline of lifetime employment. You can see figure four, the share of non-regular workers in Japan and Korea. And in table seven, the share of contract employees in China, the share increased from 1.8 to 40%, rapid increase in contract employees. And there was a transformation wage system in Japan and Korea. Existing seniority wage system has transformed significantly. Figure five shows job tenure earnings profile in Japan in large firms. And figure six shows job tenure earnings in profile in Korea. Two figures shows that seniority wage system weakened significantly, but it did not disappear completely. It's kind of hybridization. Companies, major company introduced the pay for performance wage system. Okay, how to evaluate this transformation? Hybridization or transition? I argue that there was hybridization rather than transition. Professor Miyazawa showed that there was a hybrid firm in Japan, and I chose the Miyamoto's research. He found four types of Japanese firms. Here, type three, new J-type firms. This is hybrid firm. Has a large proportion of in corporate sector. Table nine. Synthesize the trends of liberalization and privatization in three countries. Figure seven showed another way in diagram. Okay, this is 2011. There was considerable transformation in four sectors: size of government, credit market liberalization and the labor market privatization and capital liberalization. Now, I would like to suggest some unsustainable growth regime in three countries: finance-led growth, Japanese growth, polarized growth, and the low fertility, aging society. Okay. Table 10 is very important to understand the three countries' capitalism. Transformation of capitalism, growth rate of productivity and real wages. You can see here, in Japan case, Japanese case, in the 70s, productivity increase rates is similar with wage increase rates. I think this era, this period is a kind of Japanese golden age of Japanese capitalism. But in 80s, the trend reversed. So not even, anyway, the wage rates increase became low. So there was a gap between productive increase and the wage increase. It's a signal of emergence of bubble-led growth or finance-led growth in Japan. And in 90s, very low growth in productivity and wages, lost decades. It continued in 2000. How about in Korea? You can see here, Korea case is, this is from 1984, seven, the year of work's great struggle in Korea. And this year is Korea's financial crisis. I think this period, wage rates growth was higher than productivity growth rate. I think this period is a golden age of Korean capitalism, but this trend reversed rapidly from financial crisis. And Korea experienced low growth rate and low productive growth and low wage growth. How about in China? Now China is experiencing a kind of wage-led growth. You can see here, wage rate increase is a lot higher than productivity increase rate. Total factor productive growth in Korea, China, Japan. In Korea, Japan, the TFT growth rate is very low now. And this is summarized, this summarization of transformation growth regime in three countries. And Japanese growth, this is also unsustainable growth regime. And the polarized growth, figure 8 shows wage difference between large firms, in China case, SOE and SMEs. In Korea and China, the gap is rapidly widening. Gini coefficient in Korea and China and Japan is increasing. I constructed flexibility triangles. You can see here, labor market flexibility, 6 minus employment flexibility legislation EPL index. So this axis represents labor market flexibility, and this axis shows unemployment benefits and active labor market policy expenditures as a percent of GDP. Professor Peters yesterday argued that Northeast Asia matches Nordic Europe, but in my view, it doesn't match well Nordic Europe. As you see here, this is a Korean case. This is the United States, and this is a German flexibility triangle. How about Sweden and Germany? This is Sweden. It is close to a golden triangle. And the next, Germany is similar to Sweden. So this figure shows Korean capitalism and Japanese capitalism cannot be sustainable with this flexibility triangles. Table 13 shows the estimates demographic impact on per capita growth. You can see here, demographic dividend disappeared Korea, China, and Japan. In 2030, the negative impact of demographic impact would be minus 0.9, the largest negative impact in Korea. This is a serious problem in East Asian model. Okay, let me conclude. The transformation has resulted in hybridization rather than transition of developed model. The element of Anglo-American model has been introduced to the existing EADM. There were hybridization between corporate market economy, CME, and LME, liberal market economy in Japan, between regulated market economy and the liberal market economy in Korea, and between socialist market economy and the liberal market economy in China. Consequences of transformation was unsustainable growth regime, finance-led growth and the Japanese growth and the polarized growth. In order to realize a sustainable development model, 30 countries should have a new sustainable growth regime, innovation-led growth, job not jobless, job rich growth and shared growth and low carbon intensity growth, especially in China. Thank you for attention.